Tansi, Jalasi, welcome. I would like to welcome all of you to the iWICL 2015 graduation. It is such an honor to have all of you joining us here today. Without further ado, I want to bring in this year's graduates so we can begin celebrating their remarkable journey. I have on the stage with me right now our elder Beverly Jeddore from Eskasoni, and I also have an incredible friend to our program, Andrea Curry. She was also a mentor, and they are going to sing the honor song as the cohort comes in.
Thank you.
Thank you both so much. And thank you to all of our IWCA graduates for sharing your voice in that. That was a really powerful moment. I don't know if all of you felt that, but my heart was going, woo! To begin, I want to acknowledge that we are on the traditional unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. And I want to extend my sincerest gratitude to all of the community and the ancestors and all of the beings in this territory for allowing us to meet here today. We have such gratitude for the welcoming Mi'kmaq community. As somebody who just moved here, they have been a great source of welcoming and support for me. So it's with deep gratitude that I thank them for allowing us to meet here today. Now, it is traditional in our communities that we always open very special events, well, in most everyday life sometimes, with an opening prayer. So I'm going to ask Beverly Jeddore back to the stage. Beverly is our elder from Eskasoni. She has been with us for the 2 weeks of the program in August, and it has truly been an honor to receive her teachings. So I'm going to turn this over to Beverly.
Enjoy your day today, and I'm so proud and honored to be with you.
Thank you so much, Beverly. I realized that off the top that I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Robyn Bourgeois. I am senior program teaching staff here at the Coady International Institute, and I am the lady who is taking over the program in a sense. I am the main person responsible, and it's truly been a joy, and I'm so happy to be here today as your MC. We have some special guests in the audience with us here today. We had the Antigonish mayor is here, the warden from the county of Antigonish. We have members of our Legislative Assembly, Randy Delory, and our representative from Imperial Oil, Lorna Carlson, is here today with us. We also have members of the university staff and faculty and the local community, and I see a lot of Coady faculty in that audience. Thank you so much for coming. Now, this man, I think, holds a special place in the hearts of this group. I think there are going to be a couple of memories that they take away with them that certainly have to do with music and fruit salad, and perhaps also hockey. So I want to call to the stage our interim co-director, Gord Cunningham.
Thank you, Robyn. Good afternoon, everyone. Well, I too want to begin my remarks by acknowledging our presence on unceded traditional Mi'kmaq territory on behalf of Coady StFX. Thank you for allowing us to gather here. And thank you to Elder Beverly. For your prayers and your warm welcome. And a special thanks to Elder May Louise Campbell and Jamie Goulet for gracing us with your presence. And of course, Elders Dorothy Moore, Sister Dorothy Moore, who is not with us today. But I do see a couple members of the Sisters of St. Martha up there, so welcome. To the 2015 Iwacol graduates, how does that word sound? I'm really honored to be part of your graduation today. I really am. I shared some time in the classroom with you. I've been able to sit in on a few of the presentations these past couple of days, and I have to say, it's a dangerous thing to say for someone in my position, but you may well be the most committed, passionate, enthusiastic, energetic, and fun group of women I've ever worked with. Yeah. That's right, today we celebrate you, but also we celebrate the Iwacol graduates who come before you. This is the fifth cohort, so this is the fifth anniversary of this ceremony. You've all helped establish the reputation of this program, and most importantly, you've been instrumental in creating positive changes in your communities, and you will continue to do so. Collective awesomeness is how I think of you. Our program is a unique one, and its strength really comes from many sources, and one of these sources is the mentors. I think you would all agree with me. They're an amazing group of women. We have some here today who've been here since the beginning and some for the very first time, but we have more than a dozen of these amazing women here with us this afternoon. And we thank you from the bottom of our hearts. You really make this program special. This program would also not be possible without the support of Imperial Oil Foundation. This was conceived with them. They've been in it from the start. They're our founding donor, and they have not only been a funder, as you can see from Lorna's participation, they are a true partner. They have helped spread word about the program. And as you know, Lorna herself has given up 3 days of her life to come and spend with us. And listening to her talk at the luncheon, I feel honored, really, truly honored to have a partner like Imperial Oil Foundation. So thank you, Lorna. There's a great quote by Chief Oren Lyons from the Onondaga Nation in upstate New York, which I'd like you to consider today. Although we are in different boats, you in your boat and we in our canoe, we share the same river of life. We're all part of the same river of life. And today, as you continue your journey downstream or upstream, especially upstream, know that you are not alone. You have supporters in your community, you have each other, and you have a network of Iowa graduates of more than 55 who've come before you, of 7,000 Coady graduates who've come before you around the world, and of tens of thousands of StFX graduates who've come before you and are part of your network. I'd like to mention one of those graduates for a moment who is no longer with us. We were absolutely heartbroken earlier this year to hear the death of Lacey Morin Desjarlais, a graduate of the program, the IWICL program in 2012 from Saskatchewan. She graced us with her passion for dancing and helping connect children with their cultural ways of life and their language. She had an indomitable spirit. You know, I can't remember, I'll never forget her in the classroom. I was doing a presentation of a digital version of the Leaky Bucket, and she spoke, put her hand up and said, you know, can this tool be used to track household finances? And I said, sure. She said, can we have a demonstration of that right now in class? And I said, and she said, I'm willing. And I said, okay. And she said, I guess there's never a good time to learn about your household finances. And there's that sense of fun and adventure and bravery, really, that I will always remember. And we miss her. And we remember her today. So IWICL graduates, the entire Coady and StFX community, we all honor your commitment and your passion, and we will celebrate your successes in the future. We look forward to further collaborating with you, and I mean that. We want to see you again here, and we want to see you in your communities. Thank you. Miigwech.
Thank you so much, Gord. I know I said this in the introduction, but I think these ladies grew very attached to you, and we will always think fondly of our time in the classroom with you. Now, it's truly, truly my pleasure to introduce the next speaker. I have had the good fortune of knowing her, I'm trying to think how long, many years now. I actually had the opportunity to live in her community for many years, and I have been nothing but inspired by her. Our keynote speaker today is Beverley Jacobs. Beverley holds a Bachelor of Law degree from the University of Windsor, a Master's degree in Law from the University of Saskatchewan, and she's working on her PhD. Close. How I got to know Beverley is that Beverley was the champion of the Sisters in Spirit campaign for the Native Women's Association of Canada. She has fought long and hard to protect our women from violence. They did a lot of work with Beverley as president. She was president for a number of years, and the work that they've done continues to reverberate in our communities. We are so pleased that Beverley can be here with us today, because I'm telling you, if you haven't heard her speak, she's about to rock your world. I'd like to call to the stage Beverley Jacobs.
It's an honor. As greetings of peace to all of you. I told you my real name, my Mohawk Bear Clan name is Gowenkuse, and it means she's visiting. So I have been honored to be invited here to honor you, the graduates. And but also before doing that is to honor your ancestors and to honor the ancestors whose territory here, the unceded Mi'kmaq peoples. And know that when I talk about my name, she's visiting. I have lots of visiting all across the world now. And I also have many spiritual visitors. And so they helped me to say what needs to be said in many of the public speeches that I've done. And so I'm very honored to be able to say what needs to be said, because this is in honor of you, those of you who have been involved in this program. And I think it's an amazing program to acknowledge the role of women as leaders in our community, and that you have graduated from such an amazing program. So what I want to do actually is to share some teachings with you. I have a bit of time, I think. Somebody's going to tell me when to stop, because I can speak for hours. And first, also acknowledging the elders and those who are here, and the leaders as well from the university. Thank you for your words. So those of you who know where I come from Haudenosaunee peoples, coming from your neighbors, the Mi'kmaq peoples, our relationship also is very historical in our relations long before the colonizers ever showed up on our shores. And so we used wampum. Wampum is a sacred spiritual object that we've always used, and we've used them in creation of our wampum belts. And we use that as a means of our history, to remember our history. And so what this one is, to honor you, is the what's called the women's nomination belt. And a lot of times, even our own chiefs, our own leaders in our community, when we talk about the great law of peace, is to forget about the role of our women and the role of our clan mothers as leaders in our community and the decision makers in our community, and how we are all connected as women. And so this belt was first created when our peacemaker came through our territories and acknowledged the role of women as leaders in being our clan mothers. And so I see that in you as a leader, in your role, in your communities and where you come from, that you are our future clan mothers. And that you learn, part of this acknowledgement is your role and knowing what your role is in community. And a big part of that is about acknowledging your source to our Mother Earth. And so that's what this centerpiece in the center represents, is that connection and the direct connection as women to our Mother, the Earth, and leaders of our longhouse. So that's also the center in here. The center is our house. So you're a leader in your house in being that clan mother. And that also the role of women is that we're all connected. So that's what that solid line represents. And so because we're all connected as women, that we have that a huge responsibility, and a huge responsibility to be strong, to be connected, to understand your roles and responsibilities in your community and where you come from. And I always talk about how we have that responsibility as women to know where we come from our own strengths, our own responsibilities, your connection to your land and your territory. So when you introduce yourself, even in your language, in your nation, all of us have that connection when we acknowledge our nationhood, that it's directly connected to the land. And when it's directly connected to the land, that's when we know that our feet are grounded and that we have that responsibility in this lifetime to look after 7 generations from today. So that's a huge responsibility. And sometimes we forget about those responsibilities that we have because we have all of this outside world that we have to also live in. So this would have been made maybe 1,000 years ago, maybe 500 years before colonization, acknowledging the role of women, and also acknowledging that there's always a balance, there was always equality. So women chose the male leadership. And when women chose the male leadership, that's when that balance came into place of gender and responsibilities, of male and female responsibilities as leaders in the community. So I'm going to speed up ahead about 500 years, and our Coady Institute leader here acknowledged the words from Faith Keeper Orrin Lyons. So he was one of my teachers. And having one of those teachers to acknowledge, so this is the river of life. In our language, it's called Guswenta. So that's this relationship of my ancestors, first with the Dutch, the French, the British, and with the United States. And so what this acknowledged was our relationship with the colonizers. And it was always about, there's three basic principles: peace, respect, and friendship. And so this represented, this line, this purple line, represented the colonizer's ship. And this other line represented our canoe. And that we would follow in each other's footsteps, actually not interfering in each other's way of life. But unfortunately, in many of the colonial institutions, like universities, have interfered in our learning or in our well-being. So all of those institutions, like law, like education, our social systems that we are forced into, has been in your ship. And so what I see happening, and there is a shift, is that we are now returning to understanding, revitalizing, reclaiming who we are as a people within our canoe that we've always had, and one of them being the role of women. Women, you as young women, those in your communities where you come from, have taken the brunt of colonization in its worst forms, whether it's violence, whether it's murder, whether it's being missing. But I would have to say we are the strongest people that exist in the world. We are the strongest people because of our ancestors. We always give thanks to our ancestors. We feed our ancestors. And they're the ones who feed us. They feed us and help us to understand that history today. And they're the ones who are always with us, no matter what. In our teachings, we call them, we have four beings or four protectors. So they're the ones who are always there to protect us or to help us to learn. So whatever it was in our past that has had an impact on who we are, it's them helping us to learn. You know, there's reasons why we're here today, there's reasons why you're here today, there's reasons why you've learned what you've learned in your lifetime. And that to take all of those things that you've learned and to help it grow in your future, in whatever you've planned, in whatever decisions that you've made, is to celebrate that. That we have a right to celebrate that we're no longer victims, we're no longer just survivors, but we're winners. You are winners. You are the ones who are going to take these teachings and run with them. You have the ability to do whatever you want to do in this lifetime with all of that privilege. The privilege of learning and education in this white world, and also learning and using your tools in your Indigenous ways. That's something that I was told was a gift. It's a gift to be able to learn two different ways of life. And that's what we do. As Indigenous women, That's what we've had to do in this lifetime. As Indigenous people, we've had to do that. And that's a lot of work. And when you're in an institution, all of a sudden you're given that responsibility to say that you speak on behalf of all Indigenous people. Well, that's hard. That's hard to do when you're told that responsibility, when all of a sudden it says, oh, well, what do you think? What do you think about what's happening to Indigenous women? And do you think it's Indigenous men who are doing that? Or for whatever the question is, all of a sudden it becomes your responsibility. Well, I'm sorry, but I think it's up to the non-Indigenous peoples to be educated about who we are and about their own history and where they come from and their roots and healing. And that's when I say that we are so amazing as Indigenous women. You are so amazing as Indigenous women to be able to have that kind of knowledge and to be able to carry that with you with honor and with truth and with that strength and to be proud. Never be ashamed of where you come from. Never be ashamed of who you are, because that was part of what this process tried to do. The whole intent was to erase us as a people. The whole intent was for me not to be able to stand up here. The whole intent was for you not to graduate, but that's changed completely. The whole thing is shifting. Everything is shifting because we have that responsibility to our Mother Earth. You have that responsibility. We all have that responsibility. And that's what makes it amazing to me as human beings in our language. When we say Ongwehowe, it actually means human being. And so it was never about color. It was never about race. It was always about our responsibilities as human beings in this lifetime and in this world. So we all have that responsibility. And so I want to thank you for the honor to honor you, to honor all of your hard work, to honor whatever it is that you've decided to do from today. And I'm in who I am as an Ongwehowe woman, as a Mohawk woman, to be able to be here at this moment in time, to be able to, and this cohort, to honor you and to honor all of that work you've done. And I look forward to all of the work that we have to do in the future. Yawa, thank you. So actually, I have just one more thing. I have gifts for all of the graduates that I made. So those, you know, when you have really nice earrings that you have and you lose one? So I've kept them. And I'm moving back to my community in about 5 days. And so I saved all of them, and so I was packing and unpacking and sorting and found them. So I made them each one into little pendants for you. So that'll be your gift from me. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Beverly. That's it. What an important lesson and teachings for us to hear today. Now we're about to proceed into the certificate part where we get to honor you, but before we do that, it's my turn to address you. Taka! I I think in our lives, we tend to remember our big firsts. Our first kiss, the first time we fall in love, maybe the first time we leave home, or maybe the first time you see co-interim director Gord Cunningham perform fruit salad for the first time. Those things stick with you. I always remember my big firsts, and I will always remember you as my first IWICA cohort. I only arrived in April, and I jumped right in, and you initiated me very, very well. This included multiple trips to the hospital. This included a late night rescue session from a secluded mountaintop location by our IWICL administrative assistant, Brenda, and her family. It may have also included an adventure where we painted the teepee and also painted a StFX planter. We had a lot of exciting adventures together. But all of you also very much inspired me. I saw women who faced significant challenges head on and pursued their dreams and goals courageously. I saw women who refused to take no for an answer. I saw women who transformed their entire being through their leadership journeys over this summer. I saw fierce women who fought for the well-being of the most marginalized members of our community, our children, our women, our elders. I saw women who fought for their communities and their cultures. I saw empowered women who spoke truth in strong voice. And I saw women who challenged themselves to be the best that they could be and worked committedly to achieving their goals, their dreams, not only for themselves, but their communities. There is a proverb, and unfortunately, if you've heard me speak, I might have actually said this before, because I really like this proverb. And it comes from the Cheyenne in the United States. And it says, a nation is not conquered until the hearts of the women are on the ground. And then it is done, no matter how brave the warriors or how strong their weapons. Our Indigenous nations have certainly been decimated by colonial oppression and violence. We can't deny this. But these IWICL women, they're living proof that our nations are not conquered. These women represent the beauty, the strength, resiliency, and wisdom of our Indigenous nations. We will not be conquered. It has truly, truly been an honor to get to work with all of you. I thought I was gonna get through this without crying, but they know me, I cry at everything. But I love each and every one of you, and thank you for being my first. Now I wanna get to invite to the stage a couple of people to help me out. I'm going to ask our amazing director of the International Women's Center, Eileen Alma. I'm going to ask Lorna Carlson, who is visiting us from the Imperial Oil Foundation. I'm also going to invite Beverly to the stage to join us. And to call the names for the certificate, one of the cohort's other favorite people, I'm sorry, Gord, we had to share, Brenda Berger. And these fine group of women are going to celebrate the class of 2015. Now you're about to receive a few very special items in addition to that piece of paper, that important certificate, which I know you're going to frame and put on your walls and you're going to just hold sacred for the rest of your lives, right? We are also going to give you a scarf, just like the one I have on right now. This is a collective way of marking our connection together. And they actually come, I'm going to tell you, they actually come from one of our own mentors, her connection from Marie Delorme, who made these really wonderful scarves for us. We also have a small gift from Beverly, not a small, I mean it's a gigantic gift to be honest. What an amazing offering. And then when you come and visit me, I'm going to honor you with a pin from StFX. So I'm going to turn the mic over to Brenda so we can start with certificates.
Deep breath. Polly China. Darlene Cox. NGO, Andrea Curley. Thank you. Linda Fox Trudeau.
Thank you, Brenda. Jade Villa Harper. Kirsty Henderson. Cheyenne Henry.
Wabshki Gizis Kwe Alana Jones. MiKenze Jordan. Kiera Dawn Folsom. Adeline Large. Holly Logan. Veronica Marlowe. Jolene Mercer. Lorena Rising. Lori Sokoluk.
Practice makes perfect.
Iska Spillett. Tachin. Deidre Thompson. Caitlin Tolley.
Congratulations, ladies. You really earned this. Now it's truly my honor to introduce this next person, and I can't promise that I won't do this without crying, because that's our thing, we cry. I got to follow this person personally. And when I met her, I was worried a little bit. I wasn't sure how she was going to handle this journey. And I followed her and watched what was happening. And I went to visit her this summer. And when I got there, I was floored. She was an entirely different person, entirely different. She was this bold, strong, fierce woman. And I came back to Coady and I kept telling everybody, you will not believe this. And apparently I wasn't the only one who saw this. I challenged these ladies to pick a valedictorian. I said, I'm not interfering in this process. You have to come to consensus. And they came to me just last week and they said, we've got someone. She doesn't know yet, but we've got someone. They pick this woman because she has made the ultimate transformation as a leader. She has gone through an incredible journey, and she has emerged as one of the most incredible women leaders I have ever seen in my life, and her colleagues felt that way too. It is truly, truly my honor to welcome to the stage the valedictorian for this class, MiKenze Jordan.
Didn't bring any Kleenex. Because I'd like to say that I'm not going to cry, but, you know, I'm just going to embrace who I am. So, my name is MiKenze Jordan. I'm Cree from Mascouches, Alberta, from the Montana First Nation. I just want to thank everyone for being here with us. Thank you to our elders. to the Coady faculty and staff, to our instructors, to our mentors, to the families and friends that were able to come and here, be here with us, but most importantly, to my peers. I'm truly grateful to be entrusted with this honor to speak on your behalf of the Indigenous Women in Community Leadership Class of 2015. It truly has been an amazing experience, life-changing. I know we would all agree. I'd like to take a moment to share some of my experience and how this journey has brought an abundance of change over my life in every aspect. I heard about this program 2 days before the deadline and was surprised that it was even suggested that I even consider applying. Did I see myself as an Indigenous woman in community leadership? As each of us knows, sometimes we have to take that leap of faith and trust that what is to be, will be. When I was accepted, deep down I was so happy, but there was some anxiousness. Doubt started to creep into my mind. Was I a leader in my community? Was I really Indigenous enough? I had to really think about that, and I knew I had to start work immediately. I started praying. I had to get really honest about what I thought about myself. There were lots of beliefs and questions that had been detrimental to my life. I was not good enough. Why had I been chosen? But I don't want to dwell on those things anymore. I spent too many years being hard on myself and not believing that I could be more. I had to change how I saw myself in this world. If I was going to be a strong Indigenous woman leader and influence change, I would need to let go of those old beliefs. They would no longer serve me and the work that I'm going to do. So how did this change for me? Well, just take a look at each and every single one of these women here. They changed me. They influenced how I saw myself. It was their strength in that circle in May. I knew my life was going to be different. I wanted what they had. But yet again, I started thinking in a dark way. I spent 3 weeks with them, and I was blown away by the work that they were doing in their communities, with their families, and in their own lives. I spent 3 weeks here and did not really find my voice. But I went home, because I remember standing in that circle. Wondering how I could change and be what I wanted to be. You know, and I came home, and it was hard. It was really hard. You know, there were days that I didn't know if I was doing enough. But what kept me going is that I wanted to come back here. I wanted to make them proud. I wanted to stand with them again. I spent my whole life thinking that I was one way. And Marianne Williamson has lots of quotes. And one thing for me that changed is that I had to perceive things differently. I remember talking to Robyn and to someone when I first got back here this last couple weeks. And we talked about the change and what had changed for me. And the biggest thing for me is that I was always focusing on all the things that I didn't have, all the things that had gone wrong in my life, You know, being a child of the 60s scoop, not having those parents or not understanding or blaming, and being in an adopted family that I just didn't feel accepted or that I could never be what they wanted me to be. But it's not true. I can be who I want to be. Creator has given us each gifts, and he's given me the gift of this program, of these women here who stand with me, because this is not about me. This is about us. It's about us taking this time to stand together, to really create change in our community. I want to share a quote by Chief Dan George. It's, "May the stars carry your sadness away. May the flowers fill your heart with beauty. May hope forever wipe away your tears. And above all, may silence make you strong." This summer, one of the things that changed for me is that I spent a lot of time by myself. I spent a lot of time sitting in a graveyard, just in the quietness. It was like my place. And one day I was sitting there and I was thinking, we talk about our ancestors, and I was thinking about mine. Even though I might never know them, I might never see their face, I know I have to carry forth the work that they did, the sacrifices. I was reminded of those little children in residential school. What they must have been thinking. But we must honor them. And I knew I must honor myself. I could no longer think that way about myself. And as I sat there that day, and I prayed, and I cried, and I offered tobacco, I thought about how we see graveyards. And for me, it changed that day. Because in that graveyard, there's a lot of love. And that was what I wasn't accepting into my life for so long. As I think about these women, and I'm going to remember those days when I feel sad, or when those doubts start to creep into the back of my mind, that I'm changed. I'm forever changed. And yes, there will be tears, but I honestly believe that I will be able to stand in front of people, and those tears will be gone. I no longer have to live with them, because I'm going to stand tall, and I'm proud to be a strong Indigenous woman. So I want to invite the women to stand and say with me one more time that we are strong Indigenous women leaders. We are strong Indigenous women leaders.
See what I mean? She's fierce. We gotta watch out for her. She's gonna change this world. Before I welcome our elder back to do a closing prayer, I just want to invite you one more time to congratulate this cohort, these graduates of 2015. Can I ask you to stand and give them a huge round of applause?
Now for the last time, till next time, I want to call forward our elder, Beverly Jeddore, to offer a closing prayer for us.
I'm cracking. Did you hear that?
Ulan nu gebjik. Ulan mual tan del iganadu dis iganadu ulan ulan mual. Beji da ji gula de te de. Aha. They knew where I was,
renewal that I was committed to you, that I left my home and I left my children and grandchildren to come and be with you in prayer, and also to be to celebrate with you, especially this day. I ask that the Creator help you and guide you. And I didn't say this in my when I was talking just a minute ago, but there's no goodbyes in our language. There's no goodbyes. There is the word mutis, which means I will see you again. And I'd also like to acknowledge our elder, Mayor Louise. I love you. And I thank you for teaching me everything that you have taught me this week. Aki Mau Jamie, thank you for the ceremony last night. It was so powerful. And I didn't want to leave. And I needed that.